Ricky Gervais, welcome. So, I won't translate that clip. Someone else will have to do that. But thank you for sending us that clip. It's as we are watching Afterlife here in Norway and Sweden, I know you've been watching a lot of Sofia Helin and the bridge, and she's with us tonight, as you can see, with Elsa Hosk.
Hi.
I know. Hi. Bridge is one of my favourite shows of all time. In fact, it started me on these Scandi noir and all European sort of dramas. That was the first big one that I watched. I was like a child. I wouldn't watch things with subtitles till about 5 years ago. And now I can only watch things with subtitles.
So when you are watching Sofia playing Saga Norén, if it was possible for her to see you as well,
yeah,
through the screen, what would she see?
Oh.
She'd see a fat bloke in his pyjamas with a glass of wine. Like that.
So tell me, on that note, what is your relation to fashion? How important is fashion for you?
Right. Well, as you can tell, I'm a slave to fashion. I gave up fashion when I was about 25, I think. And then once I got fat, it was I just want comfort. So
Elsa, give Ricky one fashion item that he could use. What would be his thing?
You know, the piece that he could use. Give the ladies what they want. More skin. Just more, yeah. Like what you said, on the couch, naked, more skin.
I've already got way too much skin, but I need a lot of skin to cover my body.
Okay, so, Sofia, you got this suggestion for Ricky.
Yes.
Go on.
You don't need to put on anything special because you can just use your eyes. They are glittering like this. We don't need to see any suit.
Yeah, it's the alcohol. They're watering.
Yeah, probably.
Thank you.
I was watching Afterlife, your series, and it's about a guy who loses his wife. She's dead, and he tries to go on living, but he feels that his life is pointless without her. I wonder, is this depicting in a way your worst nightmare? You've been with Jane since the beginning of time.
Yeah, well, that's the initial idea was, you know, if you lost everything and you were going to kill yourself, but you didn't, in this case, because the dog was hungry, you know, which is funny and true, you know, you still have duties, you still worry about stuff, and the guy thinks, okay, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it on my terms. I've got nothing to lose anymore. I've always got suicide to fall back on. I can say and do whatever I want. That was the initial idea, that sort of vehicle to suddenly deliver anything you wanted. It was like a superpower. And then I had to think, well, what's losing everything? And for me, it would be your soulmate, your life partner. That's where it started. But selfishly, there's a line in it where the lady in the graveyard who's lost her husband, you know, says, I'd rather live missing him than have him live missing me. That's how much I loved him, you know. And I'm selfish. I want to die first. But that's selfish in a way, but I still do.
In what way? I mean, don't. It's normal to fear death, to fear being dead. I mean, it's...
I don't fear being dead. I don't fear being dead. You know, it's. I won't know about it. That is the best thing about being dead. You don't know about it. It's like being stupid. It's only painful for others. I worry about how I die. I don't want to die in pain or lonely or falling on a spike. I don't believe in an afterlife, so I don't think there's anything, you know, to fear after death. That's just, you know, my belief, you know. And people say, you know, what do you think it's like after you die? And I think it's like the 13 and a half billion years before you were born. And that was all right, wasn't it? So...
I read, Ricky, that because last time we spoke about your cat Ollie, and I read that he passed away.
Yeah, she died. Jeez, just before lockdown.
It was she. You've
misgendered my cat. How dare you?
I'm sorry. It's the name Oliver that confuses me.
Yeah. Well, it's cats don't mind. They don't care if you call them a man's name or. No, it was a lovely little a female Siamese cross, and she lasted 16 and a half years.
I have a Tonkinese.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, they're great, aren't they? Yeah, she was half, she was
so
quarter Tonkinese. Yeah, yeah, they're great.
Yeah. So smart. And,
I have two hamsters. Smart. Does it count?
I had a hamster when I was little. Yeah. Yeah.
So?
Yeah. I love hamsters. Yeah, they're great.
They're cute. They're
massive testicles, the hamster.
Oh, I have two females.
It must be the biggest ratio of testicles to body of any animal.
Okay.
The hamster's that big, and the testicles, they hang out the back like they're stealing, shoplifting melons.
Tell me, did you have to make that decision yourself that it's about time to say bye bye?
Yeah, yeah. She'd been ill for a couple of days, and we took her to the vet, and they sort of gave her something, and then she wasn't getting better, and you sort of burst into tears and say it's now, and took her to the vet, which is the kindest thing to do.
How old was she?
16 and a half.
Oh wow, she was so old. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Did I ask you because I had to do the same with my dog this spring.
Oh,
and
it's terrible.
And the thing is that people don't understand it. It's just us having animals that can understand this. But it's a tough.
Yeah. I can't stand the idea of an animal in pain. I've never could. I've never understood animal cruelty. I just don't get it. I just think if you don't have empathy with animals, you don't have empathy. I just don't understand how you can't. They are us.
Did you get, because I thought that was a weird choice, whether to get the ashes or not. They offer you to get an urn with the ashes.
Yeah.
Did you get that?
Yeah, we did, but we just, you know, we spread them in the garden. I'm not superstitious or anything, but we've spread.
Because I got this urn, it just says dog. I don't know if it's my dog.
So you don't mix it up with gran, dad.
Ricky, it's been next year. It's been 20 years since The Office and your big breakthrough with that series.
Yeah, that's amazing.
I wonder if that were to be launched today and seen for the first time today, how would it be received?
I think it would be received the same way, but there'd just be more complaints because. That's some people's job nowadays, is to complain and be heard and be offended and try to get things cancelled. And I think a lot of it is totally fake outrage because they're shouting out of a window and they want someone to hear them. Some of it's stupidity, where they don't understand it. I mean, I think a lot of offence comes from people mistaking the subject of a joke with the actual target. You know, because, you know, you can't legislate against stupidity. But you have to ignore it and you have to stick to your guns. And there's things that, you know, 15 years ago that were really right on and woke and ironic and, you know, ridiculing those things. But now people are taking them on face value and they're ignoring the context, ignoring the satire, ignoring the irony. And they know full well that it came from a good place, but I think people just want to cause a ripple.
It's not all, always about what happens now either. It can be about what happened 20 years ago as The Office.
Oh, it's ludicrous. Kevin Hart did some tweets 10 years ago that he deleted and apologised for at the time. And then he lost his job as host for the Oscars because he wouldn't apologise again. And he's right, because if there's no value to saying sorry and moving on, we might as well not change, you might as well carry on. And I just think there's this punishment. People want blood. It's just about owning
It's always a life sentence, isn't it?
Yeah, it always comes back to haunt you. You can never, you know, saying sorry isn't enough.
I just wonder, which side of politics do you see as the biggest threat against the freedom of expression today? Is it the left side or the right side?
Well, there's no such thing as a side anymore. It's ridiculous because it goes left and right, and then extreme left, extreme right, extreme left, extreme right. They come round and meet. Mm. It's extremism that's the problem, and Twitter amplifies that. If you're mildly conservative on Twitter, you're Hitler. You know, if you're mildly left-wing, you're Trotsky. And if you're a centrist, they both hate you and you're a coward. There is no nuance, there's no argument, you know? It's just... And it ups and ups and ups. I think that extremism is threatening everything. And people are liars, and they pretend it's because of what you're saying, but really they just don't want to hear it because you're not on the right side. There's so much hypocrisy and lies, and the more you tell a lie, some people believe it. And that is like the new politics. Lie enough till people believe it and it becomes a truth.
Thank you so much for using this room again for your right to free speech. It's always wonderful to talk to you. And I know that you're writing season 3 now, right?
Yeah, I've nearly finished because I had more time on my hands than I thought I'd have this year. but we'll be filming next April, hopefully. If there's still a world, I don't know what's going to end the world. I don't know whether it's going to be a civil war or a pandemic. But I just want to get out Afterlife 3 and then you can end the world.
Well, like a cockroach, I'm still here. You know, it's yeah. I'll be here anyway. So, yeah. See you again. Thank you so much, Ricky.
Thank you.
Ricky,
thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.